with a unique combination of huge potential. Energy-hungry region and growing domestic demand, Nepal is in an exclusive position to tap the hydropower opportunity. With economical feasibility of generating 42,000 megawatt with current installed capacity of just over 1,000 megawatt. Nepal offers huge investment opportunities in this sector. As Nepal is celebrating the energy decade, government has put high emphasis on hydropower sector and intends to produce 15,000 megawatt in the next 10 years. The government envisions one province, one mega power project and calls for private sector investment on the sector. Powering the future with cleaner energy, invest in Nepali power sector for shared prosperity.
As we've been saying, and we reiterate, this is an endeavor and a journey for Nepal towards sharing prosperity. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, allow me this privilege of inviting on stage our distinguished panelists. First and foremost, I have the privilege of inviting and extending the warmest of welcome to the chairperson of this panel, the Honorable Minister of Energy, Water Resource and Irrigation of the Government of Nepal, Honorable Mr. Barshaman Pun. Ladies and gentlemen, he's also a standing committee member of Nepal Communist Party, and he has held ministerial portfolios at the Ministry of Finance and also the Peace and Reconstruction Ministry at various times. We one more time extend our warmest welcome to the Honorable Minister. Said that, I turn to the session's moderator. My pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, of inviting the Executive Chairman of Hydro Solutions, who is a hydropower specialist and entrepreneur, and is an electrical engineer by training. He is also an energy and hydropower expert, and in that capacity advised the Economic Advisory Council of the then Prime Ministers of Nepal in 2012. He is currently involved in several hydropower projects and certainly is an enthusiast and has been leading in the sector since a long, long time. My pleasure of introducing and inviting on stage the panel moderator, Mr. Gyanendra Lal Pradhan, ladies and gentlemen. Thereafter, if I may invite on stage the presenter for the panel, Mr. Sagar Raj Gautam, who is the senior divisional engineer and presently heading the developing cooperation section at the Ministry of Energy, Water Resources and Irrigation. Throughout the years he has been in the government service, he's been basically working in the area of environmental impact assessment, licensing of hydropower projects and supporting bilateral and multilateral cooperation coordination. He has also been involved in negotiations of the concession agreement and he's actively associated with the various bilateral mechanisms in the sector. Mr. Sagar Raj Gautam, a warm welcome. My pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, of inviting the Managing Director of Nepal Electricity Authority, who is credited for liberating the country from nearly a decade-long acute power crisis. He has also served as the managing director of the Chilime Hydropower Company under the Nepal Electricity Authority and holds decades of experience in power generation, transmission, distribution and trading business, and which includes contract management and dispute settlement in hydropower companies. Our warmest welcome to our distinguished panelist, Mr. Kulman Kissing. Ladies and gentlemen, our other panelist is Mr. Sanoj Kumar Jha, who's an officer of the Indian Administrative Service and he is currently posted as secretary at the Central Electricity Regulatory Commission of India, the central regulator in the power sector of India that functions under the provisions of Electricity Act. He has worked in various capacities with the state governments of Sikkim, Jharkhand, as well as the government of India and the UNDP in the past 21 years of his career. A warm welcome to Mr. Sanoj Kumar Jha. My pleasure of inviting up on stage Mr. Song Dong Shen, currently serving as the President of Power China International and the Chairman of Sinohydro. And he has been working in the company for over 30 years now. Since 1990, Mr. Song has worked in many countries and regions for marketing, project contracting and operation, and is seasoned in international contracting market. He enjoys special expertise on EPC, BOT and PPP. Ladies and gentlemen, our final panelist for the panel is Mr. Muhammad Mahbubur Rahman, the Chief Engineer of the Bangladesh Power Development Board, Bangladesh, and is entrusted with all the IPPs, cross-border power trades of Bangladesh, and is a member of joint working group of between Bangladesh and India and Bangladesh and Nepal. Having extended my warm welcome to all the distinguished and esteemed panelists, I have the pleasure of handing over the floor to the session moderator. I'm yet to invite Dr. Krishna Prasad Oli, the member of the National Planning Commission, as one of our esteemed panelists on stage. My sheer apologies in that. And having invited all our esteemed panelists up on stage, I turn to the session moderator, Mr. Gyanendra Lal Pradhan now.
Okay. Thank you. Seeing the audience, I will really encourage. Thank you, MC. And thank you, Baini. Honorable Minister of Energy, Water Resources and Irrigation, Mr. Basaman Poon, presenter, panelist, distinguished guest, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. What we can see that energy is basic for human life. And if you see the energy availability in the South Asia, the per capita is one of the lowest in the world. The per capita is one of the lowest in the Asia. Just compare China and South Asia. China is having installed capacity about 17 lakhs in Nepali or 1700 gigawatt power today. And in 1700 gigawatt power, 350 gigawatt is coming from hydropower. And China is rapidly going forward with the renewables like solar and wind in big way, in many thousand megawatt. And when solar and wind is not supplying power in the evening or when the wind is not available, the hydro, 350 gigawatt, is supplying stable power in China, making the system very much stable. In other place, if you see South Asia is about 1.5 billion population. India is the biggest country, having about 350 gigawatt installed capacity. As compared to China, it's very small. And if you see Bangladesh, it's about 20 gigawatt. Nepal, 1 gigawatt. Bhutan, 1.5 gigawatt. So total installed capacity is less than 375 gigawatt as compared to 1700 gigawatt, what we can see in China. So South Asia is going in higher speed than China now. India take over China in GDP growth. And South Asia needs lots of energy. And if, when we say Nepal, this is the right country, right place, right topic that's called hydropower we are talking today. I don't take much time. I expect we have a prominent panelist from China. We have prominent panelists from India, from Bangladesh. And I'm very much thankful to Honorable Minister for chairing this session. And Minister will brief everything at the last after we all panelists finish. So let's go to the panelists first. Before going to panelists, sorry, I have to go to Mr. Sagaraj Gautam. He prepared some slides regarding Nepali's power sector. So I want to request you, the floor is yours.
Namaskar. Good afternoon. Thank you, Gyananji. In the interest of time, I would directly jump into the presentation. Honorable Minister and the Chair of the session, let me start my presentation with the energy mix of Nepal. When you look at the energy mix for the year 2016, the total energy produced was around 13 million ton of oil equivalent, and out of which the majority, around 66%, came from the fuel wood. The contribution of the energy from renewables and the electricity accounted just a little over 6%. And if you look at the mix of projected energy requirement of around 17 million ton of oil equivalent for the year 2050, the 33% will have to come from the electricity and renewables. Here we can see the substantial dominance of the electricity and renewables in the projected energy mix for the year 2050. Now, looking at the electricity mix in the system of little over 1 gigawatt installed capacity, 86% of the installed capacity is dominated by the mix of few ponderous run-of-the-river projects, plants, and the numerous simple run-of-the-river plants. In the mix, the storage facility accounts for mere 92 megawatt. Now, on the brighter side, with encouraging involvement of private sector, around 2.5 gigawatt of the installed capacity are actively undergoing construction through various IPPs. And among these, around 2.5 installed capacities are expected to be online within next 4 years. Likewise, for around 2.6 gigawatt, NEA has already entered into the PPA with various developers, and they are looking for a financial close. Besides, the NEA is also undergoing processing of PPAs for around 5.6 gigawatt installed capacity. This is one of the study prepared by WECS, Water and Energy Commission Secretariat of Nepal, which has projected the generation requirement of little over 29 gigawatt by 2014, and with some policy intervention in, for example, replacing energy source to be used in the water heating, household cooking, and transportation, the generation requirement projected for the year 2040 accounts a little over 36 gigawatt. Now, in Nepal, the major resource base for electricity generation is the available water resource in the country. And if you look at the river system of Nepal, more than 6,000 rivers and the rivulets spreading between the highest elevation on Earth and the lowest altitude of less than 100 meters, and generally traversing north-south within a short span of less than around 200 kilometers, gives us a potential to generate hydroelectricity. With the water resources available in the major river basins like Saptakoshi, Saptagandaki, Karnali Mahakali, and in the southern river basins, there is a potential to generate hydroelectricity of around 42 megawatt within the country. Now let me highlight some of the key electricity figures for the year 2018. 87% of the population, 87% of the population has an electricity access through grid and off-grid solutions. But the consumption is a bit of a low in tune of 200 kilowatt per hour capita. System loss for the year 2018 was 19%, and it is decreasing. Electrical energy generation was 4,500 gigawatt hour, and the electrical energy import was 2,600 gigawatt hour. Let me present some of the sector targets, and these targets has been a lot talked about in the morning in the different sessions as well. So with the base year as 2018, the government has set these targets, and we intend to continue to work in pursuing these targets along with the roadmap and the activities, which will also be in well reflected in the next 5 years plans that our National Planning Commission is currently working on. With these backgrounds, let me present some of the guiding policies adopted for the development of electric sector in Nepal. what are the policies? The guiding policy is basically a constitution of Nepal. I spell out a few words, reliable supply, ensuring reliable supply of energy in an affordable and easy manner by generating and developing renewable energy sources. We have a hydropower development policy, 2001, and it has acknowledged the hydropower, hydroelectricity, also as an exportable commodity. And it embraces the BOOT model of project development, and it also covers the risk arrangement. Electricity Act 1992, it was also talked about in the morning, and thanks to this Electricity Act, which has allowed the private sector participation in the development of hydropower projects, and because of these acts, as I've indicated in the previous slides, the contribution of the independent power producers in the hydropower industry is already approaching 50% in terms of installed capacity of the country. And the projects that are being currently developed, most of them are from the IPPs. And for the electricity market, if you look at the internally with the transmission system development plan and the distribution system, with the transmission system development plan in place and the distribution system master plan is in the making, we are pursuing the aggressive reinforcement and expansion of the transmission distribution infrastructure within the countries. And in the external front, our active and constructive engagements with the bilateral mechanisms with India, Bangladesh, and China, we see activities under these as solid foundation in operationalizing connectivity and trade. Again, internally, the NEA is looking at to forming a province-wide distribution companies in order to support internal electricity marketing and also following the envisaged generation mix in the system. While on the external front again, in the long run, we see the tremendous opportunity to expand bilateral arrangement of the electricity trade into trilateral, quadrilateral, and beyond through the mechanisms like SARC framework agreement, BIMSTEC grid interconnection MOU, and the BBIN forum. Now let me briefly touch upon some of the facilities that are in place for the development of the hydropower projects. And we talk about the BOOT model for the private investment, nominal royalty to be paid to the government, guaranteed water rights, foreign exchange facility in repatriation, dollar-denominated projects, progressive rates for the PROR and storage projects, and fiscal intensive incentives in terms of the VAT exemption and the in terms of the income tax exemption. So these are some of the facilities that we have to offer. And then we do have a practice of entering into the concession agreement if required. While previously mentioned facilities are generally covered in the concession agreement template, these risk sharing arrangements are also captured in such agreements. To cite some few, backstopping against the non-payment by the off-taker, sharing of hydrological risks and benefit, use of international standards on the environmental and social sustainability, protection from changing law, parallel compensatory mechanism in case of event of default, project handover mechanism, and transfer price determinations. Now, in case of investment opportunities in the public sector projects, the government through its agencies are conducting studies of the several hydropower projects. And we already know that development of the storage projects are priority for us. So these are some of the projects that are being showcased, which is the information of these are also available in the website of the IBN. So these are the projects that have been showcased, and these are one of our opportunities in case of the public sector projects. And in case of the private sector projects, the private sector sponsors have been studying and developing numerous projects under the licensing framework, and the range of projects are available at the different development levels for the prospective investors. And when I say the range of projects, then it is under the survey license, the study license, and the advanced studies of the generation during the generation license application phase and the projects with the generation license. that there one can see the opportunity for the investor to look at. Sorry about this. I was approaching to the last slide, and then this happened. These are some of the initiatives. In the recent past, the transmission company, generation company, power trading company within NEA, merger of irrigation and the water resources in the Ministry of Energy to form a Ministry of Energy, Water Resources and Irrigation are some of the institutional arrangements that we have embarked upon. And with the constitution in place and embracing the overall governance of the country through federal, province and the local government, we are in the process of formulating the overarching Water Resources Policy and Act and the subsequent Water and the Electricity Act. Basin-wide Hydropower Development Master Plan is being updated or prepared by Water and Energy Commission Secretariat and the Electricity Regulatory Commission. The government is looking at operationalizing this commission as early as possible. Now with this new PPP Act and the Foreign Investment and Technology Transfer Act, along with other legislative arrangements, we are confident that the investment environment will be more conducive for the development of the electricity sector. But to conclude, I'd just like to summarize by saying that the potential to harness water resources for hydroelectricity with the evolving electricity market, domestic and cross-border, and the positive reforms in our policy framework have created investment-friendly environment in the energy sector. We request you to consider the avenues for the investment that have been offered, and the ministry is committed to extend all the necessary support and assistance. And for the further information, you can visit these three sites, the Ministry of Water Resources site, Department of Electricity Development, and the Office of Investment Board, Nepal. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Sagarji, for highlighting Nepal and some policies and the plans, how Nepal government going forward with the hydropower sector. When we say energy, naturally the biggest source of energy is sun. There is no comparison of sun energy and any other energy. It's much, much bigger, many times, many hundred times bigger, the solar energy. The second biggest energy is coal. Nepal, we don't have coal for that one. Third biggest energy is gas, and comes the renewable, then comes the only hydropower. But when we say hydropower, naturally we have two components. It's a hydro and power. When you say power, there are two components again. It's a regular power, base power, competitive with, let's say, the coal energy, or for the peaking power. And if you see China, if you see India now, the region and our country is fit exactly in the best location. Regarding potential for any business, we have to see the potential, and potential we have, we don't know exactly 43 gigawatt or 83 gigawatt or 200 gigawatt. We don't know exactly, actually. It all depends upon you design for the water value, you design for the flood control, you design for the peak energy value. I can give you one example. Like Arun 3, we designed for 300 megawatt. Now for peak energy value, it become 900 megawatt. If you design Arun 3 for water value, it can become 1500 megawatt very easily. So this megawatt is changing. It depends upon what value you want first. And naturally, the water value is first for the region. So potential is untapped. Second, I can see the market. Inside Nepal also, we are importing power from India today. We have to replace that one. Second, we are importing lots of, let's say, petroleum products like cooking fuels, almost more than 50 billion a year. We have to replace with the electricity, with our own one. So domestic market also not very small. It can be 3,000 to 5,000 megawatt if energy is available within a couple of years. I can see that. Thanks to India, December 18, the cross-border electricity regulation, new regulation came. Everything is open now. India welcome any private sector, any government sector to sell power to India. And thanks to Kulmanji and the Indian counterpart that they are talking energy banking also, because 2020, I think we have to go for energy banking when we install Tamakosi during wait months also. Bangladesh, we must thank Bangladesh also. The minister already declared 9,000 megawatt they want to buy from Nepal. They said Nepal. They didn't say other country. They said Nepal. So regarding market, how much market, we can't imagine. The market is many more 1,000 megawatt. And we must thank our minister for putting the vision of 15,000 megawatt in 10 years. Now we need technology, which we can buy. We need fund. The neighboring country are very rich. We have some money. Now I want to go to, let's say, the panelist, first panelist. Our first panelist, I want to take from India, Mr. Sandesh Kumar Jha. He's working with CRC, who is responsible for all this cross-border trade. I just want to put one question, sir. How you see the value of water benefit through hydropower development for the regional benefit? How you see the water value in hydropower development for the regional benefit, including India?
Thank you very much. I'm honored to have been invited here. Let me first give a small background of what the CERC does. That would set the tone for, this cross-border regulations, the question that you asked. In India, we have got two sets of energy regulators. One is the central regulator, which is dealing primarily with the interstate generation, central government generating capacities, and interstate transmission lines. It also handles power market. It also handles a lot of other issues which are not under the domain of the state regulators. And state regulators are primarily concerned with intrastate generation, intrastate transmission, and consumer relationships, so in which CERC has no role to play as regards consumer relationships. This cross-border regulation was much awaited even in India and in our neighboring countries. Say for the last almost 2 years, we have been deliberating. We had come up with a draft regulation to which we got comments from Nepal, Bangladesh, Bhutan. They sent their comments and they were not very optimistic with a few provisions. So we had to have a relook into that. That took a bit longer because we wanted to ensure that the Indian grid remains stable, the neighbors get power or we can sell power to the neighbors, and the whole system works in a very friendly environment. It took a bit longer. In fact, 2 years is quite long, but still we have come up with this regulation. And just talking about the hydropower, in case of India, we also have a huge potential for hydropower. But you would be aware that for the last 4 to 5 years, we have not been able to commission substantial capacity in hydro generation. And in times of peak load, which in India is normally in the months of April, May in the first half and October, November in the second half, we have a huge shortage, to be very frank. We do have a capacity of over 350 gigawatts, but when the demand reaches about 175 to 180 gigawatts, we still have a huge shortage and we need hydropower. And that is it. In the first half, that is in April, May, June, hydro is not in a great shape as regards India. Indian hydro generating stations. So we look forward to generating capacity in Bhutan and Nepal. We have got a robust exchange, the power exchange. So those hydro generating stations which have got a power purchase agreement with distribution companies, they can easily schedule their power. But there are others. There are a lot of others which. I'm talking about the hydro generating stations which do not have a power purchase agreement. They have a option to sell their power in the shop. We have got three types of market, three types of access. We call it short-term access, that is up to 3 months. The medium-term access, which is up to 5 years, and long-term access, which is beyond 7 years. So those hydrogenating stations, I'm just talking about the hydrogenating stations, those hydrogenating stations which don't have a long term PPA or even a medium term PPA, they can easily sell their power through the exchanges. And the total capacity in the exchanges as of now is about 4 to 5% of the total capacity, total requirement that India has. So it comes to about 6 to 7 gigawatts every day. So that capacity, in fact, a lot of hydrogenating stations are using that. When it comes to Nepal, after this cross-border regulation has come into force, a hydrogenating station in Nepal can connect directly through a dedicated transmission line to an Indian pooling station. They can use the cross-border transmission link that can be developed by the two governments through a mutual agreements. That link, they can use that link, and power can be transferred either way. I mean, hydrogenating station can sell power when they are surplus in Nepal to India, or through the same link, the Nepalese distribution company, they can buy power from India. So this regulation would pave the way for substantial transfer of power in the region, at least between Bhutan, Nepal, and Bangladesh, which are directly connected, to some extent to even Myanmar and maybe even Pakistan.
Yes, sir. The location value of India is very, very important, because India is a bridge between all these neighboring countries. We can't go direct to Bangladesh, we can't go direct to Myanmar, we can't go direct to Sri Lanka, we can't go anywhere. Any country can't go anywhere except India. So the policy from India plays the biggest role for the regional power trade. I've been to Tehri, sir. I've been to Bhakra Nangal more than 15 times. I can see similar project is possible very easily in Nepal, because you can see all these untapped potential is available, like Bhakra Nangal and Tehri. So can you share something how Tehri is contributing the peak power, the flood control, and even the global warming, minimizing the global warming effect, and supplying drinking water even to Delhi? Can you highlight a little bit, sir?
The hydro stations have got a very special position in our energy mix. See, I mean, except for the monsoon season, the hydro generating stations are available only for say 3 hours or at the most 4 hours. I'm talking about the big ones, not the ROR types. So what the regulator, the state regulator and the central regulator has done, that we say that if a hydro generating station is available just for 3 hours in a day, it would be presumed that they are available for the full day, and they are paid as if they are available for the full day. We have got, say, in case of hydro, there is hardly any variable cost. What we have done is that we have notionally divided the full cost into two parts. One part is, we say the variable cost, other is the capacity charge. Though there is no variable cost in reality, what, say, Tehri would be an example in this. What we do is that, say, if Tehri is available just for 3 hours, we pay them the full capacity. The distribution companies pay them the full amount of capacity charge. So what it means is that, say, for the full year, if they are available just for 3 hours a day for 80% of the time, 80% would be roughly 300 days in a year, they would be paid the full capacity charge. When they are transmitting electricity, they would be getting the energy charge. And when it comes to irrigation, flood control, and other, non-power uses, they are directly under the control of the state government. They are not through regulators, neither the state regulator nor the central regulator. The usage in these areas is decided by the state government. They get a priority over power. If the state government says that we need this power for irrigation, unless until it's very important for the power sector, it is released for the irrigation. Same with flood control, same with any other thing. But there is a clear-cut demarcation that how the hydro generating station will get its money back. So whether it is paid through the usage in irrigation, flood control, and other ancillary associated services, or through the power, it gets the full energy. And even if it is not available for the full day, even if the water is not available, I would suggest if some people from here, they take a visit, you have already been there, to Tehri, and there are a lot of other hydrogenating stations under SJVN. I think the CMD of SJVN is here. He has come for this meeting, and maybe Mr. Sharma is here. it would be really good if a team from here visits one of the projects under SJVN, Satluj Jal Vikas Nigam, or Tehri. There are a couple of others. One is in Sikkim, Tista Urja. So I would suggest if somebody visits these hydro plants, we'll facilitate that. You can send an email to me, make a call to me. I'll make that arrangement, and they can see how the whole function in totality.
Thank you, sir. I think we understood the cross power trade and about something about India. Now I'm gonna move to the northern side, Mr. Song, Power China. China is one of my favorite countries, like India. I studied in India, but I've been to China more than India. I've been to China more than 100 times. When I went 1989 for the first time in China as a youth ambassador, they took me to villages. There were no toilet. Then I decided my country is much better than China. Our infrastructure is much better than the Chinese, let's say, villages. I've been there more than 120 times now. I can see the way China growing in each and everything, especially in power sector. That's encouraging very much. So how China see Nepal as a potential investment destination in energy sector?
Yeah, the first of all, I would like to say something about myself. I'm Chinese, but I'm a Nepali mention also. My Nepali name is Guru. So the first time I come to Nepal is 1997. I worked here 2 years. So as at that time, I know in your office better than Sinar Hydro's office. So I love Nepal. So I can say I know something about Nepal hydropower resources. And also I'm a hydropower engineer. I can say I know Chinese. And also I work in many, more than 120 countries. So I know global situation. So what I want to say is, in coming years, I am quite confident Nepal will become the largest investment country for Chinese fund, Chinese technology in hydropower sector. So why I say this, I can give you some reasons. The first, Nepal, you have the best hydropower resources, and also you are applying very important rule in the region. I strongly believe Nepal can become an energy hub for the region, for India, for Bangladesh, even for Tibet. So this is the first. Second is, to invest in hydropower sector is 100%, in line with One Belt, One Road initiative, proposed by President Xi. And the third one is China. We have a huge capacity for investment, for technology, for whatever in hydropower sector. So now the Chinese hydropower investment, coming down quickly. So we have surplus capacity. We need to move this surplus capacity to other countries. I strongly believe the Nepal will become the largest country for Chinese fund, Chinese technology, whatever, in hydropower sector. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. China doing great. As already I said that China got the biggest potential in hydropower sector. That's about 7 lakhs megawatt. That's 700 gigawatt. And from 700 gigawatt, more than 50%, let's say, more than 350 gigawatt already installed capacity. That's with more water value, irrigation value, drinking water value, flood control value, and always the water is first value in China for the hydropower sector. And I can see more than 100 gigawatt under construction now. In China, almost all big power project is going to complete in the next 10 years. After that, there'll be no other big potential available for the construction. So for Chinese company, it can be the best country because they have resources, they have technology, they have turbine manufacturing units, they have contractors, very efficient contractor. So this country can be one very strong investment area. My question to you now, sir, Mr. Song, South Asia, I said South Asia and China is almost same size. If you compare energy, water per capita, if you compare anything, flood problem in China is very less, which was too high 30 years back. In South Asia, the flood is coming not in 20 years. Every year we are getting flood.
Can you repeat?
Flood. F-L-O-O-D, flood.
Can you repeat?
Yeah. When you compare China and South Asia, China is too big country with a big population. South Asia also not very small. China, like China, South Asia also, if you consider as a one region, it's like China population. But if you see the energy per capita, China having 4,000 units a year per capita. But in South Asia, it's much lower, almost 10% of that only. If you see the water value is not coming to the hydropower in South Asia. But I can see the water value in hydropower in China is much higher. So how hydropower can be used to get the benefit of, let's say, South Asia, the way China is getting, giving the water value, peak energy value, and the other energy value?
Yes, South Asia population is almost similar to Chinese population, but the installation capacity per capita is a big difference. China is around 1,300 watts per capita, but now in South region it's about 250 something.
Plus, literally,
yeah.
Plus.
So there's a difference. So that means there's a huge potential. Now India, Bangladesh, Nepal, every year your economic growth is around 7%. That's a very fast growth. So that means you have a huge demand for energy. That means there's a huge potential, huge market for power. So so not only China, I think other countries. Power China is a partnership with some Japanese company and Qatar Middle East companies. We decide to team up to invest hydropower in Nepal to provide energy for South Asia, for India, for Bangladesh. Power China, besides is an EPC contract. Now we already did one investment project, Upper Ma'anshan D, 50 megawatts, more than 2 years operation. Now we are promoting another two hydropower, Lower Arun and Upper Chishuli 2. And also we are promoting a route from Kathmandu to Hitola. So that means many other Chinese companies, they would like to team up with us, with Power China. So because they know we know Nepal much better than them. So we are Power China. So we would like to make more contribution to increase the installation capacity in the region. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Song. You are president of Power China International Group, so you know Chinese capacity and you know the international market. When we say international market, your neighbor market is one of the international market for you. And I can see the big interest, I can see the big Chinese friend in the highest level coming. And we urge all of you to come to Nepal for the investment because you get the best price in South Asia. The South Asian price is much higher than China, much higher than the US, much higher than Canada, much higher than Brazil. Means once you get the best price, you have money. So I can see the potential to gain good for the country, good for me, good for my country, and good for you. Nepal can be the best country for hydropower. And I don't think the potential will last very long. Many, many friends are coming. I'm expecting $5 to $10 billion to this summit. I'm a layman, I don't know exactly, but I'm expecting $5 to $10 billion commitment in hydropower sector in this summit. Thanks for that. Okay. Let me go to our Honorable National Planning Commission, Dr. Oli. The biggest problem is now global warming. Global warming. You can see global warming is the biggest issue. Even in Nepal, the glaciers is melting very fast. The dry months, water going very down. The wet months, water coming up. The cloud burst rains coming up. You can see snow in Kathmandu these days, which we never saw in our childhood. So how you see the global warming and the potential of hydropower to match together?
Thank you, Gyanendraji. It is, I think the earlier two speakers have brought quite a lot of things. I will start to answer your question through a statement which was made by our friend, Suraj Baidyaji. Nepal is a mountain of opportunity. Mountain of opportunity. So this is one of the biggest opportunity. But one of the challenge which you have posed, we are at a time of significant change in global energy market. And the contribution of hydro and other clean energy is increasing. You know, the whole concept of, you know, climate change is basically related to greenhouse gas emission. Emission from different sources. So for your kind information also, for all the audience also, there are some very latest research which has been carried out, particularly in case of hydropower development. Using hydropower instead of conventional sources of energy, such as coal, fossil fuels, avoided 148 million ton of air polluting particles and 62 million ton of sulfur dioxide and 8 million ton of nitrogen oxide. This is actually recent publication which was done by International Hydrological Association. So there is a tremendous potential if we go to the hydropower sector for this. And another thing is, you know, by generating electricity from hydropower instead of coal or fossil fuels, the world actually prevented an estimated 6 billion metric ton of greenhouse gas and avoided about 10% rise in global emission. Again, this is also by International Hydrological Association. This is the latest study which they have done. But what you said actually is, you know, rising temperature, it is basically related to the global temperature rise. I was also a member of IPCC. So the whole idea, the concept is to maintain the global mean temperature at 1.5 degrees Celsius. Okay. So even if we actually maintain 1.5 degrees Celsius, our temperature will, our mountain area, or both in Tibetan Plateau and Nepal side also, and the whole Himalaya region, the temperature will rise. Chinese Academy of Science is continuously monitoring in Tibetan Plateau for the last 30 years. So they found a rise in temperature, about 2 degree differences. So that means actually the snow is melting faster, glacier retreatment is coming. So this is how it is happening. But having said that, what earlier speaker also mentioned, actually the key to hydropower is it offers storage services. Storage services, even if we have less snow, we have storage services which the monsoon will bring. The whole actually geographical and evolutionary concept of the formation of this Himalayan rain is directly related to the climate system. The Bay of Bengal, you know, the year with water laden year comes, it throws back and rainfall will be there. Even if temperature rises, rainfall will be there, monsoon will be there. Even if we don't have snow, monsoon will be there. So the key to this is the hydropower, which offers storage services, which supports growth and other renewable water management, protection of flood. Recent study has actually come up. 15% of the flood-related hazards have been reduced or controlled because of the dam project, hydropower dam project. And of course, it also helps in mitigating the climate change because it also acts as a sink, carbon sink. You know, if we have lot of hydro dam projects, they also work as a sink. And changes in microclimatic condition, which means enhancing vegetation, that means carbon sequestration will come, and so that is how it will go to answer your question in climate change related.
Yeah, thank you. So naturally, hydropower is a multiple benefit. It's related to food security also, of course.
Of course, there are other things also, tourism promotion, you know, flood control, drought, you know, control, irrigation facilities, navigation, all these things, you know, they will come with that.
Thanks, sir. Since you are in National Planning Commission, you are the one to plan for the country. and we have to follow you through the investment, helping the government. How you see the national policies, new national policies to develop hydropower and energy sector the government is taking forward? We have seen little slide from the Sagarji, but can you tell a little bit more how the government planning for the energy sector development in future, sir?
Okay. Well, energy is the naval cord. If you see the discussion when it is put in SDG Goal 7, because it is considered without energy, nothing will happen. So it is a naval cord for the growth and development of any country in the contemporary world. So in consideration to this, Nepal Ministry of Energy, Water Resources and Irrigation and National Planning Commission has come up with a forecast for 25 years. That is, in 2043, we will be producing 4,000 megawatt of energy in this country. That time, our consumption will be over 4,000 kilowatt hour per capita. So this will one. 4,200 kilowatt per hour.
Yes.
So accordingly, the growth rate will also go at a rate of 10.2%. So our energy will be another policy which we have adopted. Our energy policy will be based on mixed system. Hydropower energy system will be a multi-purpose. We say multi-purpose. It will control our flood. It will develop our tourism. It will develop our irrigation and agriculture system, supply fresh water also, and municipal use. Because by 2043, we will have many municipal areas. So industrial use. So this is another policy. We have commitment to SDG, fundamentally, meeting the need, SDG, ensuring access to affordable, reliable, sustainable, and modern energy to each of the people in this country. And the most important aspect of our policy is actually it will be an entry point for regional clean energy market and system and regional integration and cooperation. This energy system, which our honorable minister actually tried very hard to negotiate between many neighboring countries, this has opened up some of the road for us to integrate ourselves into the regional energy mechanism and, of course, economic integration. So these are the broad policy areas. We have worked in transboundary area, cross-border trade of energy. India, Bangladesh, and other countries also we are working. And the most significant step forward in the policy arena is energy banking, which is coming up now, which will be very important component. We have started getting some benefit also out of that. Maybe my colleague will brief you later on. Energy will be our major transformative vehicle for our growth and development in future. And for that, in order to meet that, this morning also, it has been presented, and our friend has also already mentioned, I don't want to go in detail about all these policies, but two fundamental milestones which we have actually started, and I think they are about to be promulgated now. It has been through from the parliament. 2X, Technology Transfer Act 2019, and Public-Private Partnership Act 2019, this coming. So they will be basically our milestone in policy, and what they will do actually, these two pieces of legislation will actually encourage cooperation and collaboration. It has a flexibility to work, public-private partnership, service delivery mechanism, sharing and caring, as our panelists from China also mentioned, from India also mentioned, sharing and caring, very important, from one country to another country, from government to private sector. So this is another thing which will be facilitated with the enforcement of these two acts. Good project governance, this will be another which we would like to go, and effective monitoring and evaluation system. We recently have visited Upper Tamakosi. Honorable Minister also went this frequency within country and joint monitoring system, this will also be evolved, project financing, and credible and stable stability of the policy. So these are some of the things which will enhance our implementation capacity, and these are some of the things which our policy in future will address. Of course, the policy, all the policies have been mentioned this morning also, and our presenter, our colleague engineer Saab, he has also already mentioned the most important and fundamental of our Nepal's policy is the Constitution of Nepal 2015, and in this also 51 Article 51, which clearly states about our policy.
Thank you, sir. This will really encourage. When we say greenhouse gas, we say climate change, we say we are in global village. So naturally, investing in hydropower in Nepal is not only helping Nepal or the neighbors, it's helping the globe. The temperature will be maintained, and food security will be much better. The glacier melt will be less. So it's multiple benefit, not only for the Nepal can contribute, not only for Nepal and neighbors. Nepal can contribute for equally for the whole globe. The China can get benefit, the US can get benefit. Okay, next, let me go to next neighbor country. It's Bangladesh. We have engineer Mahbub Rahman. He's the chief engineer, Bangladesh Power Development Board. So I have a question to you, Mr. Rahman, that Bangladesh is going very fast. I can see Bangladesh was having about, if I remember, 4,000, 5,000 megawatt in 2006. Now they have almost touched 20,000 megawatt. Suddenly your minister come to Nepal and say, my market is much bigger for you. I want to buy 9,000 megawatt from you. So how you cope with your domestic demand, domestic market, and the power connection from Nepal for this 9,000 megawatt?
At present, our generation capacity grid base is around 18,000 megawatt. And with renewable and with captive power, it's more than 21,000. So our highest generation so far is around 12,000. And in the coming summer, we are expecting around 13,000 will be our demand. So at present, we are importing 1,160 megawatt from India. And as per our you know, we have a master plan, and it is projected up to year 2041. Keeping in mind that by year 2021, we like to have the status as a developing country, and by 2041 as a developed country. It's a very ambitious plan. And you know that to achieve this position, to achieve this, achieve the GDP growth rate, electricity will play a significant role. So as per our private sector, as per our power system master plan, 15% will be imported from the neighboring countries. So that means, as in a higher case, it will be around 12,000. So we are now importing 1,160 megawatt, and another, and we have a power purchase agreement with the Adani Group, Indian developer, for a coal-based power plant, dedicated power plant, it's around 1,600 megawatt near to our border. So at present and in future, around 3,000 will be importing from the India. So out of 12,000, 3,000 is already with India. So rest 9,000. So for this 9,000, our Honorable State Minister, he finds that the Nepal will be a potential destination for importing hydropower. This is the one thing. And another thing is that as per our private sector, as per our power system master plan, we have also going to diversify our fuel mix because our indigenous gas is gradually depleting. So now in future, our fuel mix will be around 30% from our indigenous and LNG-based power plant. Around 35% will be indigenous coal and imported coal, and around 22,400 from nuclear power plant, and the rest 12,000 will be from the imported power from the neighboring countries, not only the neighboring countries, maybe the sub-regional and regional power trade also.
Okay, thank you. When we say power trade between Bangladesh and Nepal, you can see it's a tri-relation, three-country relation. So naturally, India, Bangladesh and Nepal, we need to work together. So how are the things going forward for the power trade between these three countries so that Nepal can supply some surplus power to, let's say, Bangladesh?
We all know that very recently India, they have issued their cross-border power import and export policy, and it enables that any Bangladesh can have power trading with other third countries by using Indian transmission corridor. So this is one of the good news, and it's a good instrument for sub-regional power trading also. So now we are in a discussion and on the way negotiate finalization of the almost near to finalization of the negotiation for importing 500 megawatt power from developer GMR. They are going to develop a 900 megawatt Upper Karnali hydropower project in Nepal. So out of this 900, we are going to buy 500 megawatt. And for this 500 megawatt, we are going to finalize the PPA, that the party will be Bangladesh and the GMR group, Nepal. And for transaction, accounting, scheduling, NBBN, India, they will also be another party. So there will be one PPA comprising three parties. And for using the transmission corridor, we have to sign another agreement with the PGCIL for long-term open access. Now I think things become more easier.
Okay, thank you very much. I think things are getting much more clear, because power is not for one country. Naturally, hydropower is for the multiple use, for the all the benefit, for the regional benefit. And Bangladesh, Nepal, India, even Bhutan is working together in BBIN. Now I want to go to Kulman Gisingji. He is Managing Director for the Nepal Electricity Authority. We must thank Kulmanji and the Minister for making the industrial power cut zero. Before that, they make a power cut zero for the public. We were suffering almost, even as a public, we were suffering huge power cut. And after that, we were so happy, at least in Lakshmi Puja, in our let's say, auspicious God praying day, the power cut became zero. And we are very much thankful to Honorable Minister also that the industry power cut was cut down during his tenure. Now industry getting 24 hours power. So it's a good chances for you to come to have the good power supply and put it that one. So Kulmanji, NEA is totally different entity. It's a government. So can you briefly talk about the NEA's power purchase policy for the bigger projects with the new PPA policies? Can you highlight something?
Thank you. ENI has now opened the power purchase window for almost 15,000 megawatt for next 10 years. Government has announced the target for next 3 years, 3,000 megawatt, by next 5 years, 5,000 megawatt, and by next 10 years, 15,000 megawatt. That 15,000 megawatt is that we have opened the market for 15,000 domestic market. We have different hydropower sources, reservoir, peaking runoff river, and runoff river projects. Mostly the private sectors are engaged in runoff river projects, and we have devised different rates for different types of hydropower projects, runoff river projects, different rates, and peaking runoff rivers from 1 hours to 6 hours, different rates are there. And reservoir projects, we have different rates. So we have already devised the rates for different types of hydropower projects. We have already shown that the generation mix, how we'll come up with the 15,000 megawatt. How much will be the reservoir, how much will be the runoff river, and how much will be the peaking runoff river. Different posted rates are there. The price tariff for Nepal's hydropower is transparently devised. You can have the rates, fixed rates, for up to 100 megawatts, and above 100 megawatts, scale effect will be there, and there may be some negotiations also. And we have fixed IRR-based return on equity of 17%, and that the rate for this, the rate upward increment of rates is not allowed, and downward downward price adjustment is there. If the return is above 17%. And we have two types of PPA, up to 100 megawatt Nepali currency PPA, and from above 100 megawatt, we can go for dollar PPA for 10 years for debt portion of the investment. So that is up to 70% of investment, debt portion, and that is up to 10 years. And we have, government has already issued the guideline for currency risk hedging mechanism, and there are three parties for negotiation to settle the currency risk and to have the hedging mechanism in place. And almost we have 6,000 megawatt PPA we have already signed. Out of that, 530 megawatt is already in operation. I think Upper Mersangdi, Chinese developer, they have already mentioned that our payment mechanism is efficiently in place. We didn't default even a single day for whole of the IPPs. And dollar PPA, we have other dollar PPA also, Khimti and Vortigosi, and some other projects we have already signed dollar PPA. Mostly small projects below 100 megawatt is domestic investment, so we have local currency PPA. Thank you.
Yeah, you can see that especially for two type of project, PRO and Storis, Nepali Electricity Authority is offering one of the best price as comparable to any other country. It's more than 10 cents in one sector for 6 months, and more than 12 cents in storage. I don't think any other country offering this price, because I check with Canada, even Canada not offering this price. I check with the US, I check with the China. I found that the price is much, much lower as compared to what India is offering. Because the value for this storage power is much more higher for the region. And I can see sometime in India, the power price is jumping to 21 rupees Indian currency. It's touching sometimes. Because maybe the solar is not supplying at night, in the evening, and the power load is increasing, the air conditioning load is increasing right from almost 8 p.m. And can you tell us something shortly about Sanosi, that how this Indian price is too much variable, from 3 rupees to 21 rupees, and hydro will not supply during 3 rupees, hydro will supply during 21 rupees. So within 1 minute, can you highlight a little bit how the price is going too high, and how hydro can make this 21 down and the make make the sector much more viable for the finance?
You are very correct in that sense. We have been experiencing this fluctuation over the last 2 to 3 years. Just to give a background, we have got about 90% of the power purchase is through long-term PPAs. So there is no fluctuation in that 90%. Now the remaining 10%, about 5% is through the market, the power exchanges. In the power exchanges, we have got 15-minute slots. There is a cap of rupees 20. We think it may the prices might have gone higher than 20 if the cap was not there, but it's just a guess. What happens that in many cases, I told you earlier that in the months of April and May, and in the months of October, November, at times even September, there's a huge demand for power. The hydro is not available. The wind is very little. We have got constraints with coal. We do have coal. We do have huge reserves of coal, but the coal transportation has become a constraint at many cases, and because of that, there are a lot of power plants which are running on just one day availability of coal. So what is happening? There is a deficit of roughly 500 to 1,000 megawatt, and since there is a coupling between the buyers and seller bids over the exchange, the rates that we see is at times 16, 18, 20 rupees, though the average is about 6 to 7 rupees, but the highest prices have gone to roughly 20 rupees. And you have correctly said that hydro can solve this problem, because if we have got more sources of hydro, either through Nepal or through Bhutan, it would help rationalize our prices. Though these prices are not all over the day, all through the day, but in a few blocks, maybe 6 to 8 blocks, every block is 15-minute block, we do have huge prices. So yes, I mean, if we have got enough hydro reserve through our neighboring countries, it would solve the problem.
Yeah. I learned in China and Canada that more and more solar and wind is coming. You need more and more hydro to match this one. Otherwise, these two systems is never going side by side. It has to go together. Thank you, panelists. Thank you, everybody, for that one. Now, I want to go to our Honorable Minister, Mr. Basuman Poon, for his valuable closing remarks for the session. Thank you, sir.
Distinguished speakers, presenter from my ministry, Mr. Gautam, ladies and gentlemen, I am very happy to be with you in this parallel session on energy, where we focus on power generation for economic transformation. The title for this session has been coined by the organizers for two reasons. First, the present government's campaign for prosperous Nepal and happy Nepali cannot be realized without complete economic transformation of the country. Second, such transformation can only happen when adequate energy or power is generated to drive the economy. In other words, energy or power generation has to be a major driver for Nepal's economic transformation. Demand for energy is increasing globally. Despite efforts to develop clean sources of energy, fossil fuel is still a dominant source of energy. In this region, large numbers of people are yet to have access to electricity. If properly harnessed, Nepal's potential for hydropower development can make a difference in correcting the energy supply situation in the region. As Mr. Gautam mentioned in his presentation, my ministry has set ambitious targets in the power sector for the next 10 years. In the next 5 years, we intend to provide access to 100% of the population through a mix of grid and off-grid systems. In the meantime, we are implementing several transmission and distribution system reinforcement projects to be able to provide reliable electricity services to the people. In the next 10 years, we are planning to have about 10,000 megawatt generation capacity for domestic consumption alone, with another 5,000 megawatts for cross-border trading. These targets can only be met with the involvement of and investments from the private sector. A good part of that is expected to be of foreign origin. We are well aware of the risks perceived and problems faced by different players in the sector. We have been devising various mechanisms to manage those risks and ease the problems from time to time. I must tell you that we are keen on promoting the public-private partnership model in various forms. To this front, we have already announced a program called People's Hydropower Program to develop significant number of projects with a modality that ensures intense public participation. Through this process, we are able to pull together scattered resources for the equity financing, which is otherwise difficult to arrange. Over the past couple of years, we have accelerated the pace of reforms in the sector, even though it has been challenging to unbundle the sole public utility in the sector. We have been successful in creating a generation company and a transmission grid company. 7 distribution companies are now being planned to be under the different provinces. Legal instruments are already in place for the formation of a regulator in the sector. The Electricity Regulation Commission will become functional very soon. We are committed to continue to reform the power sector and make sure that proper policy and legal instruments are in place. In essence, we are creating a favorable environment where concerns raised by all stakeholders are addressed properly and swiftly. First and foremost on our list is policy stability. We are also making sure that the tax regime and concessions provided to project developers are attractive. Mr. Gautam has already given you an overview of these facilities. As you saw in the presentation, we have numerous potential hydropower projects in Nepal for the generation of power. The major constraints in most instances in capital investment required for project development. Equity investment which can be generated with Nepal within Nepal is limited, so is the case for loan investment, as the amount of money Nepali banks can lend each year to the sector is inadequate for the development of larger projects. This clearly points to the need for foreign direct investment in the sector. Even in the People's Hydro Program, which I mentioned earlier, we will need to seek a substantial amount of debt for several projects in this program. A good part of this is expected to be of foreign origin. As most of you know, one of the basic policies of the government of Nepal is to promote private investment in the power sector. To that end, we have highly investor-friendly regulations which treat national and foreign parties at par. We have been successful to open up opportunities for access to power markets beyond our political borders. The power trade and transmission interconnection agreement with India and understandings reached with China, as well as with Bangladesh for cooperation in the power sector, have laid the foundation for cross-border electricity trade. These developments should give further confidence to prospective developers. As Mr. Gautam presented, a transmission master plan has been prepared with the involvement of the relevant authorities in India. 11 high-voltage cross-border transmission lines between Nepal and India have been envisaged in this plan. The first line, namely Dhalkebar-Muzaffarpur line, is already operational, and we are now moving first to develop a second line. You will appreciate the fact that we need to utilize the resource complementary available in the region. Our ultimate goal is to have a regional or sub-regional interconnection. That is why we are signatory to the SARC Framework Agreement on Energy Cooperation and also party to the understanding reached for the establishment of the domestic grid interconnection. Eventually, such sub-regional or regional interconnections should help us to optimize our power systems and lower the operating costs. In fact, it is not just bilateral trade, which will be facilitated by the cross-border lines. We can have trilateral or other arrangements which can be worked out at the private or government levels. As we are offering attractive power purchase rates for peaking power, proponents willing to invest in peaking runoff river or reservoir projects must find good prospect for return on their investments. We are also welcoming solar energy projects with attractive power purchase rates. At the moment, we are formulating an integrated water resources policy, which will guide to overall development of water resources in Nepal. We have also begun to develop river basin plans and a hydropower development master plan for holistic development of the various potential water and power projects. To sum up, we are gearing up to take up attractive projects in the different size ranges, requirement of equity investment, as well as debt financing for these projects will be substantial. As you know, one of the objectives of this summit is to showcase potential projects in the different sectors. As I said earlier, the government is moving ahead with ambitious targets in the power sector. In fact, our plans and programs are almost taking the shape of campaign for aggressively harnessing Nepal's hydropower resources. On behalf of my ministry and the government of Nepal, I urge you to be a part of this campaign in whatever way you can. I thank the distinguished panelists as well as members of the audience for your active participation in this session. I am sure that the insights shared by highly distinguished speakers as well as by members in the audience during this session will enable us to further reinforce our initiatives for reform in the power sector. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir, for very much encouraging for the investor. I think I can see the light in the investor's face after your speech, and you are a man of commitment. Once you say, I have seen everything you fulfill. I just want to share a small thing. Wrapping up session, I don't think we need wrapping up session because such an eminent panelist, I'm a layman, I'm a very young guy as compared to them and as per their experience. So it's, I don't dare to wrap up the session. I just want to go a little bit with 2 minutes. Like, I just want to add my experience with the people's participation in the hydropower in Nepal, because we have many friends from other countries, 39 countries, that last time I applied for 10,000 units of share for the government, people's hydropower. I'm going to get 20 maximum. Means the demand is so heavy. Means the government is going perfectly with not single second unit. They are going with a multiple unit, with a multiple, let's say, investor. Each and every Nepali, they want to make the investor in hydropower sector. That's really good of wealth distribution. So I really appreciate government for that, and I really appreciate minister for that one. But I'm very sad I get only 20 shares, not more than that. I hope the next share offer will come very soon and we'll apply for that one. Next, Mr. Song, I have very bad experience in China. I was detained by your police for 1 hour because by mistake I went to Three Gorges inside during construction. When the Three Gorges project was under construction, some Chinese friend took me inside the Three Gorges and the foreigner not allowed. suddenly I found 10-20 police people came. They just caught me. They put me in the van. I was surprised. Why they caught me? And my friend was talking with others. They put me. They detained me 1 hour. Then I came to know a further than they were allowed inside the construction of these three gurges. And that's my, I don't say bad experience. That's my very memorable experience with the three gurges. I went to three gurges more than 10 times after that. You must go and see how the three gurges is doing with the water management, navigation, flood control. There are many bad news, but when I went, I've been there for seven days together with the three gurges friends, and I can see three gurges is perfectly doing everything good like Tehri is doing in India. And there are many multiple projects doing in these two countries. I think Nepal need to learn all these good things. So what we see now is that the earth is getting hot. The water is running low. So hydropower is the solution for everything. It's for food security, it's for peak power, it's for managing power with solar and wind together with India or with China, and it's for the regional benefit. It's not for the one country, it's for the regional benefit. With this, I want to close the session because we are running out of time. I was supposed to ask two, three questions, but we didn't have time because I'm getting pressure from my backside. So we just go with the MC program now. Thank you. Thanks for everything. So let's appreciate our panelists.
Thank you indeed. Thank you, Mr. Malla, and thank you for this very distinguished panel, for this very enriching and effective deliberations. I'm sure we are taking away a lot of food for thought. However, if you have any queries, comments, we do have a short tea break in between the, the other panel that is lined up after this tea break. Before we come and head towards closing the session, we have a very important formality to execute, and I have the pleasure of inviting the Secretary at the Ministry of Energy, Water Resources and Irrigation, Mr. Dinesh Kumar Ghimire, to kindly come up on stage as we want to, on behalf of us all, present this small souvenir to our distinguished dignitaries and panelists up on stage. Ladies and gentlemen, first and foremost, please join me in extending our gratitude to the chair of this panel, the Honorable Mr. Barshaman Pun, Minister for Energy, Water Resource and Irrigation. Thank you for your gracious presence and for your important inputs. To the session moderator, Mr. Gyanendra Lal Pradhan, the Executive Chairman, Hydro Solutions Private Limited. We're extremely thankful for this very effective deliberations and for... To the presentator, Mr. Sagar Raj Gautam, Senior Divisional Engineer, Ministry of Energy, Water Resource and Irrigation. And it's with immense gratitude that we are presenting this token of appreciation to our esteemed panelists, namely Mr. Sanoj Kumar Jha, the Secretary, Central Electricity Regulatory Commission, India. Mr. Muhammad Mahbubur Rahman, Chief Engineer, Bangladesh Power Development Board. Mr. Song Dongsheng, President, Power China International. Mr. Kulman Ghising, the Managing Director, Nepal Electricity Authority. And Dr. Krishna Prasad Oli, Member, National Planning Commission. Thank you, Mr. Ghimire. And one more time, our deep-felt gratitude to the distinguished panelists up on stage. And this brings the session to a close, ladies and gentlemen. We have a... I'd request all the panelists to kindly step forward for a quick group picture. And as we engage in this, to all our participants herein, we will take a break of 10 minutes. Thereafter, we expect you back at the panels that will be held parallelly. Here at this hall, the Malhar Hall, we will be having a session on tourism, while on the other hall, we would be having a session on industry. To the panelists of both the session, we request you all to be at the Malhar Holdings, that's right alongside the lobby outside. The tea is being served outside at the Rose Garden near the overflow room. We expect you back within 10 minutes of brief break. Thank you very much.